It's Monday, and that so happens to be the day that I like to talk about monsters. I'm Jeff Arbuckle, and this is Monster Mondays, presented by Film Seizure. Even screaming won't help. That's what the poster for this week's episode says. It's 1980s Beyond Evil. So let's talk about the fascinating Herb Fried, the director and co-writer of this film. Now, before getting into the movie biz, Fried was kind of a jack of all trades. Or I suppose you should say that he's a Herb of all trades. He was a folk singer and a dancer, but also a teacher. Most interestingly, he's also a rabbi. And most of this was all before he got into directing. And before he made his first feature film, which was called AWOL, which is a 1972 film about a young U.S. soldier who deserts and goes to Sweden and meets up with a sexy extreme leftist trying to seduce him into joining her cause. Well, before he made that, he had already directed over 200 commercials. So to say that Fried was busy is a bit of an understatement. However, he's only credited on 10 films total between 1972 and 1999, though his website does say he's written and directed 15. Probably his best-known films would be Graduation Day, an early 80s slasher, Tomboy, a mid-80s comedy starring Betsy Russell, Survival Game, a late 80s action flick, probably best known for starring Chuck Norris' son Mike, and this film, Beyond Evil. Now, considering that AWOL, that's a movie that stars a sexy Swede, and the movie that came in between that one and the one that we're talking about today stars Cameron Mitchell as a farmer who is accused of bloody scissor murdering of many local girls, I could say fairly safely that I would either like to see or have seen more than half of Fried's films, and that's not bad. Now, in a more somber and probably a little bit more grotesque note of fascination, at least grotesque on my part, he's been married twice. First to someone who wrote a couple of his films, and second to a production designer and editor on, well, some of his films. And both women have passed away, so he's a twice-over widower. And that's always an interesting thing to me, because I'm not entirely sure how old he is, and yet he seems to have lived multiple lifetimes. Also fascinating about Fried, he's been a very active member of the Directors Guild and the Rabbinical Assembly of America, and he's written a lot of books about various Jewish topics. And lately, he's been most associated with writing and discussing what is called bashert, and that's finding one's soulmate within the Jewish and Hebrew community. And he specifically relates that to his second wife, who passed in 2011. So he's a pretty interesting guy with lots of interest, and most of his films have a lot of different genres that they fall into as well. Now, one more thing before I get into this flick and my three likes. Beyond Evil is kind of one of those movies that owes itself, I think at least, entirely to The Exorcist. After The Exorcist came out, not only were there instant ripoffs and various clones to come along, but the supernatural was kind of all over the place in film and books in the 70s. You could hardly get out from under the wave of Exorcist-style movies about the devil, possession, etc., and Exorcist 2 came out. And while that didn't do all that well, because it's a terrible movie, it still kept the wheels turning. Additionally, you had the Amityville Horror, a supposedly true story about a haunting that took place in a famous murder house that also had a little piece of possession involved as well. So whether it was Exorcist Heat or Amityville supposed real-life horror, horror movies suddenly and constantly tried to ape off the stylish horror genre. Slower burn scares that often dealt with hauntings, possessions, families, and the like. And that's basically what we have here with Beyond Evil. It's 1980, so it could easily pull from both movies to place itself among the late 70s, early 80s slow burn high concept and sort of classier horror film, not so much reliant on exploitation or gore as much. So this movie is about Larry Andrews, who is played by John Saxon, and his new wife Barbara, who's played by Linda Day George. And they're coming to the Philippines. When they get there, they meet up with Larry's pal, a former lover of Barbara's by the name of Del. And Del tells them that he got them a fantastic place to live, but they have to wait a couple of days for it to be finished. And in the meantime, they are put up in a fairly nice hotel, but Barbara is not happy with this arrangement. It seems that Del is always pulling these kinds of shenanigans. Now, she's probably right to be unhappy with Del, because while all of this is going on, he's gaining more and more power in a construction company by way of forcing the company to take more and more loans in order to complete a high-rise building project that is really basically meant to bring an economic boost to the area in the Philippines. Now, Del secures them a historic colonial home called Casa Fortuna, and he paid the down payment, leaving the monthly cost up to Larry and Barbara. Now, the place has not been lived in, at least regularly, for what he says over 100 years, but the mansion is gorgeous. However, the place was so cheap because the locals say it's haunted. And the first lady of the house, Alma Martin, and her husband Esteban killed each other. Turns out that it was an arranged marriage and Esteban was a total asshole. He only really married her for her status. Alma attempted poisoning him before she started dabbling in black magic and may have had a pact with the devil. Esteban swore at one point that he's changed, but it was only a ploy to regain her confidence. So he took his opportunity to try to poison her, but in doing so, sealed his own fate by the devil reanimating her long enough for her to kill him in return. Larry, because, well, he's John Saxon and he ain't scared of nothing, doesn't think there's all that much to the story. However, Barbara quite enjoyed the story, and it's even hinted at a little bit that it may have turned her on a little bit. And the first night, she's awoken by weird chanting. While she and Larry sleep, doors open and close on their own. Soon, Alma Martin watches them sleep. The following day, Larry is nearly killed when he's thrown off the spiral staircase and nearly gets impaled by a falling statue of the devil. Green haze starts to appear around Barbara. The electricity becomes unreliable, candles light themselves. The place is really beautiful and certainly cheap to rent or own, but it's maybe not the greatest place on the planet. And Barbara isn't sleeping very well either. And as she has more and more trouble sleeping, she's not wanting to be touched by her husband. So she also begins kind of playing with sharp things as well, even stabbing herself in the hand with a knife once. And when she's taken to the hospital, there's not much of a wound, and it's revealed, though, that she's in a fairly shaky emotional state. And while Larry tells the local healer in the town that he doesn't care much for the hocus pocus or mumbo jumbo, Barbara tells the doctor that she saw at the hospital after stabbing herself that she doesn't really have much faith in doctors or hospitals. In other words, she doesn't have much faith in science, while her husband doesn't have much faith in, well, faith. She sees that she's also carved a letter onto her hand, the same way that Alma did when she was dealing with her shitty husband. And things start to escalate, at times kind of oddly. The doctor, Dr. Albanos, wants to tell Larry that there are shenanigans going on with his friend Del, but Larry doesn't really want to have anything to do with that. He also stops by unexpectedly to the house and essentially comes on to Barbara. By simply touching the gate to the crypt, Barbara is able to cause the doctor's car to begin falling apart and for it to explode and be sent off a cliff. Finally, Larry decides to go see that local healer. He witnesses him do a pretty fantastic operation, and the healer wants to see Barbara directly, but Larry knows that that won't likely happen. He explains that Alma has been terrorizing the island for decades and that, well, Larry and Barbara just need to leave. So Larry takes that advice and wants to get rid of the house, but Barbara doesn't want to leave. Alma's spirit attempts to kill Larry again by using a crane to drop beams onto him, and in his shaken state, and while he's just kind of recovering from that, Del goes over to see Barbara to tell her to stop being a crazy broad and let Larry off the hook. I kid you not, Del actually says that to her. You're being a crazy broad. He's a bit of an ass. She ends up starting to kiss him and manhandling him before she tosses him off the balcony to his death. The healer, Dr. Solomon, insists that Alma's spirit is trying to possess Barbara. And at this point, the doctor's daughter, Leia, decides to go over to the place while Barbara and Larry are away and tries to cleanse the house of the evil spirit. But Alma finds her and freaking vaporizes Leia. So Del's body gets discovered and Barbara is acting quite strange. So now Dr. Solomon has to come in as a badass exorcist just like Max von Sydow, and God rest his soul. They get some supplies and destroy Alma's crypt. With her having no further place to retreat to, they are able to save Barbara just before Alma strangles Larry to death. Though, I think the doc died in this confrontation, and with his daughter also a pile of ash, I think the town is without a healer, and that kind of sucks. But, oh well, the American characters are just fine. Let's get to my three things that I like about Beyond Evil. First, I do not understand why it takes place in the Philippines, but there's something really well done with this location right out of the gate. It starts with what seems to be a native cultural dance with a man who twirls fire around to a heavy percussion drum beat. That percussion sound carries over to some locals playing a game of something similar of, you know, kind of like jump rope, but with bamboo sticks and beating them against other sticks to make that beat. It raises your blood pressure a little bit, and it starts the movie out on a high note that's also kind of exciting and exhilarating. The location does play a little bit into the overall story and the concept of the movie, and the haunted colonial mansion that has some bad juju with it, but either way, it does use its scenery nicely in a few places. My second like is how you have two very opposing ideologies, and Larry having no confidence in anything supernatural or religious, while Barbara takes no stock in science and doctors. It's a bizarre dichotomy that this movie plays with. It's almost, how should I say this, convenient? It's a way for Larry to lean in on wanting to know what's happening to his wife rationally and trying to fix it himself, but she's possessed by a witchy lady, and it's enough to kind of, you know, resist that rationality. It's almost as if the movie needed something easy peasy to pin some conflict upon by just having these two people state, by way of dialogue no less, that they have opposing feelings about everything going on while they're at the house. Now, the third thing that I like about this movie is that while it isn't that great of a movie, it's one of those movies that could play on a Saturday or Sunday afternoon. And you probably think that I'm going to say that it's this fun little basic cable type of movie. But no, that's giving this movie a tad too much credit. It's the type of movie that would play on like the Channel 4 Saturday matinee. Okay, so a lady gets electrocuted and vaporized, and there's a brief like bit of grossness with the doctor's surgeries, but you know, to learn that this movie was R-rated is kind of completely and totally insane to me. I'm not sure you would have had to have cut really anything for this to play on broadcast TV. I'm not even sure there's dialogue that is really all that bad in this. That said, this movie ultimately captures that feeling of a warm blanket. As a kid on some summer Saturday afternoon, I might have watched this while eating peanut butter and jelly sandwiches. It's a fairly silly haunting possession type of movie, but not at all a terrible watch by any stretch of the imagination. So that wraps up this week's Monster Mondays. Don't forget to check out new episodes of Film Seizure every Wednesday and a new installment of Monster Mondays each Monday on FilmSeizure.com, as well as places where fine podcasts are found, like SoundCloud, Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Stitcher, TuneIn, and Spotify. And additionally, hop on over to Facebook and Twitter to follow us by just searching for Film Seizure. You can also check out new posts at my website, bmovieenema.com, each and every Friday. So until next week, stay spooky.